Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Thank you.
redemptorem ad nostrum ad celos ascendisse credimus. Ipsi quoque mente in celestibus habitebus. Per iundem dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum. Qui tecum divinet regnat in unitate in Spiritus Sancti Deus. Per omnia saecula
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Please be seated. Dear fathers and dear parishioners, I wish you all a very blessed feast of our Lord's Ascension. Did you miss it? Today at the little ceremony, at the end of the gospel, when one of the servers comes over and extinguishes the paschal candle, there's a symbolism behind that. The candle, remember, the lighted candle, represents Christ as the light of the world. And the extinguishing of this candle symbolizes that the light of the world has ascended into heaven and has left this earth. Beautiful symbolism behind every little ceremony. Throughout Easter, we often prayed, "If you be risen with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Mind the things that are above, not the things that are upon the earth." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen. After our Lord ascended into heaven and vanished from their eyes, we just heard the angels speaking to the apostles. "What are you doing, looking up into heaven all the day long? You've got some work to do." You and I, though, we live in such a busy world with all the technology and all of our duties of state and everything else that keeps us so busy, I would advise you to do the opposite. slow down on the work from time to time and contemplate, just as the apostles were doing upon our Lord's ascension into heaven. Mind the things that are above, not the things that are on the earth. That's what we'll do today in this sermon. I just read a story about a priest. He was teaching some young children from the deep south their catechism. And they were converts to the faith, and so he wanted to elicit from these children at least some understanding of what heaven is. So he asked them, "My child, what is heaven?" And the child answers, "Well, Father, that's a place where there ain't no more work." And that was about it. So that's about the limit, I think, for many a Catholic. It's a place of no work. It's a place of no suffering. And that's all. And for the Novus Ordo Catholics, it's a place where you go to play golf and all of the rest. But heaven is so much more. What will happen on the last day when the angel tells the disciples, "You will see him coming back on a cloud, just as you have seen him rising up on a cloud into heaven today. You will see him come back a second time." What will happen? Well, this visible sky and the earth where we live they're no more than a place that we pass through, like a tent that we set up for a day. It's all just a rough sketch for a better world. And St. Paul says that all creation, not just mankind, but all creation groans and is in agony even until now. What does that mean? It means this, that every creature longs for that day when the Creator will renew them in a perfect and more harmonious order, the day that they are freed from all corruption. And this will only happen on the last day. At the second coming of our Lord, theologians and fathers and other writers teach, the earth and the sky will be the scene of two opposing changes. First, there will be the complete destruction of all the present physical order. St. Peter even tells it. The day of the Lord will come like a thief, and on that day the heavens will vanish with great violence, and the earth and everything on it will be consumed by fire. So the same sins of man that brought about the flood in the time of Noah will once more be the reason for the destruction of the present order of creation. But after the destruction is the resurrection. The total restoration of creation will happen. Once the last reprobate receives his due, then it happens. St. Peter again speaks of it. What we await are new heavens and a new earth, where according to his promise, the justice of God will reside. This renewed universe of ours will then be subject to new laws. Time will be no more. Gravity no longer will exist. The days of our weeping shall be no more, according to the prophet Isaiah. And St. Anselm, a great doctor of the church, says that this earth, which at one time sustained and nourished the holy body of the Lord, will be a paradise. Because it has been washed with the blood of martyrs, it will be eternally decorated with sweet-smelling flowers, violets and roses that will not wither. And William of Paris, he speaks of new evergreen species and incorruptible flowers, a sort of perpetual springtime and beauty. as existed in the paradise in which our fathers were placed. Everything, once this earth is renewed, will be peaceful, divinely ordered. Sorrow will be turned into joy, envy into charity. This renewed earth will be adapted to our new bodies, our resurrected bodies, that is. And we saw this on Easter, when our Lord passed through the sealed tomb, and then the following day appeared suddenly to his disciples. It says, the doors being shut, he passed through them. So our bodies will be able to pass through space like a ray of sunshine passing through a window, and nothing will have the capacity to hold us back. Our bodies will be able to move with the speed of thought. No sooner will you think of a place you want to go than you will be there, because they will no longer be held down by the laws of gravity. Our bodies will be impassible, that is, unable to suffer, but will be endowed with a strength that will free our body from any change and any weariness, and will all possess a brightness and shine like so many suns, each one of us according to his or her merits. Some will shine brighter than the others. Now, once this last judgment has been completed, our Lord will ascend back to heaven. And you remember those thrones that today he went up and he says, I go to prepare a place for you in heaven. Well, when he ascends the second time after the last judgment, he will then point out to each one of the elect the very place that he prepared for them on the day of his ascension. There is a throne now that has your name on it. St. Thomas Aquinas, he said, heaven as we know it, is destined to serve as the main dwelling place, the main house, if you will, of the saints. But that doesn't mean that you are motionless and restricted. I think that's what so many Catholics have the idea, that in heaven you're just sitting on your throne staring at God. Well, that would be enough to make heaven perfect. But there's much more. Angels descend from heaven to earth and return at their pleasure. You see that when St. Gabriel delivered the message at the Annunciation, St. Raphael came to help Tobias, and they leave, but they never leave the presence of God. And so, without ever leaving our Lord for a moment, we will be able to transport ourselves to different places. I read a story once that said this, that we are free to explore, even in heaven, the heavenly bodies, the stars and the galaxies. What makes this, to me, so very special is, if you've ever studied outer space and the galaxies and the universe, you'll know there's so much more than science has ever found. Maybe I've told this story here, but it's a true one. Scientists once pointed a telescope, one of those huge million-dollar telescopes, as far out into the galaxy as they could see. And they saw no stars there. It's just a black space in between a bunch of other stars. They left it there for 4 months. They never saw anything until the fourth month came along, and they saw that it was a whole new galaxy of stars. that they had never seen before. And so we will be able to, according to the different authors, to visit those places, as well as to visit the earth, the places where we prayed and labored, where we conquered temptations. We'll be able to visit the road to Calvary that Christ tread on that Good Friday. And we will be able to see these things all in a single glance. But the best part of all is that one day we will see the beauty of God in the beatific vision. Now, doesn't that make heaven seem a bit more interesting to hear that? And that's just the surface of it. Read, meditate on the afterlife that awaits us. There is so much more to look forward to. And what lesson can we draw from this? Well, that cross that you're carrying, those temptations that you struggle so hard to overcome and only seem to fall time and time again, those sorrows that you hold in your heart, don't mind them, not too much. Mind the things that are above. And each of those crosses, although they may not go away, will become easier to bear. As our Lord tells us, my yoke is sweet, my burden is light. When all of these things are viewed in the light of what awaits us. Today, let us meditate and think of the heaven that awaits us and ask yourself when temptation comes, is it worth giving up heaven for this moment of pleasure? May our Lord, as he ascends to heaven, remember to take us with him and to point out to each one of us the very place he prepared on his first ascension. God bless you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Per omnia saecula saeculorum. Dominus vobiscum. Sagamus Domino Deo nostro. Verbe dignum et justum est, equum et salutare. Nos tibi semper et ubique, gratias agere. Domine Sancte Pater Omnipotens Aeterne Deus, per Christum Dominum nostrum. Qui ascendens super omnes caelos, sedentque ad dexteram patuam, promissum spiritum sanctum, hodierna die in filios adoptioni onisse fugudi. Qua propter profusis gaudiis, totus in orbe terrarum mundus exultat. Sed et superne virtutes atque angelice potestates, hymnum gloriae tue concinus, sine fine dicentes.
Benedictus qui venit in nomine Domini, sanctificetis.
Per omnia saecula saeculorum. Oremus. Precepti salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audemus dicere. Pater noster, qui es in caelis, sanctificetur nomen tuum. Adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in caelo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et dimite nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimitimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentatione. Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini, sit semper, obiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Thank you.
Divus Mysteriis Summenta Percepimus, Invisibili Cum Se Quamur Effectu, Per Dominum Nostrum, Jesum Christum Filium Tuum, Qui Tecum Vivit et Regnat in Unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, Per Omnia Saecula Saeculorum.
Vos omnipotens Deus.
Pater Deus.